Hello, Airbus Cockpit Coach here, and welcome to the channel. Today we're going to talk about holding in the Airbus. There are a number of different reasons we may want to hold. Obviously it's not an efficient thing to do, for airline operations, but sometimes necessary. And it's usually a last resort by air traffic control to hold traffic back until they're ready to provide an approach. There may be a number of reasons why we would be asked to enter a hold. Usually it's traffic density, but it could be something like a thunderstorm over the airfield or snow clearance taking place on the runway, which is causing some delays. Holds are always a racetrack pattern that we fly. We'll come across and look at the charts. We're flying an approach here into London Heathrow. It's the Nugra One Hotel. Here's our approach plates, and we've left Westcott now for Bovingdon, and you'll see the racetrack pattern there for Bovingdon depicted. So there's some important considerations here we need to look at. So inbound course, very important. So that's something we need to enter into the computer shortly. Looking at your maximum speed and minimum holding altitudes, and the maximum as well. You may have a minimum holding altitude that may be due to terrain or perhaps other traffic flows, such as departing traffic from an airfield coming underneath you, for example. So there's reasons around that, and we have to take note of that as well when looking at our holding considerations. Ideally, we want to be holding as high as possible for efficiency. That's not always the case, and we'll be asked to enter a hold at an altitude given to us by ATC. We're approaching Bovingdon now. We've got an inbound course, you'll see there, of 116, so we'll get that in the box. So what we do, we left select on Bovingdon, we select hold, and we'll put in the inbound course of 116. Now we need to look at our turn direction, make sure that's right. So it is indeed a right hand turn onto the reciprocal heading of 2906. So right hand turn is in, and we will insert that. Now, as you can see, the hold's been drawn out and is armed. So whenever we're at flight level 150 or above, a turn leg will be 1.5 minutes, and below 150 will be a 1 minute leg. Now, holds can be distance or time based, so it's always the computed standard times, unless you'll see a different time put in here or a distance. So you might fly 4 mile legs, for example. We've got a max speed of 220 in the hold. We want to fly at green dot speed, and you can see now we just entered the hold now, so it's pulling us back to green dot speed. So that's ideally where we want to be holding up for efficiency. So that's the speed at which we'll burn least fuel. Won't go very far, but least fuel burn at green dot speed. I'll have a video on green dot speed if you want to have a look at that. So that speed, obviously the max speed, so the faster we are in 1 minute, we would fly obviously further. So the max speed for this hold is 220 knots, and that obviously keeps the aircraft in a safe holding area. So if we're flying 250 knots, we would go obviously a lot further in 1 minute than we are flying at 220 knots, or as today, our green dot speed, which is below 220 knots, which is fine. So speed restriction or 220 knots where we can. 220 knots is pretty common for a hold. That's pretty standard. You will see others around that are a little bit lower, and maybe perhaps a bit below green dots, or even even have flap considerations, which is not ideal. You don't want to drag out in the hold, burn more fuel. We've entered the hold at flight level 150 here. Consider that speed limit. Now this, so we've got maximum holding altitude of 170 and a minimum of 70. So obviously this hold could actually hold 10 aircraft. So they'll generally be spaced 1,000 feet apart. That's the normal restriction, and that's something we need to consider when we are descending in the hold as well. So aircraft will join the hold at a high altitude and will descend down, and the aircraft at the bottom will be cleared to leave the hold for the approach. So we're stacking top down So let's say we're being cleared now to descend. An aircraft's left the hold and would be asked to clear descend to flight level 140. We'd enter 140 here. And we don't really want to descend more than 1,000 feet per minute in the hold, because there's other aircraft around. If we had a high rate of descent, we'll be setting off, you know, TCAS systems. They're thinking, you know, if it's an aircraft descending quickly towards them. And it, we obviously want to ensure, sometimes if it's for traffic, that you get quite a continuous descent. So a slow but a continuous descent is always great. So we'd pull vertical speed, and ideally we want, you know, 1,000 feet or less. So we're descending down to 140. We can use managed descent as well. Managed descent in this scenario should also descend the aircraft at 1,000 feet a minute. So we just selected descent and 1,000 feet. Managed descent is a little bit safer than using vertical speed. Obviously, you could inadvertently put a climb into vertical speed. So that wouldn't be a good situation if we've got an aircraft above us that's also descending. So managed descent should give you an 1,000 feet descent in the hold. So in the hold, there's a few considerations. Obviously, we want to think about our fuel, you know, and how long we're going to be in the hold. Quite often, air traffic control will say, look, enter the hold at Bovingdon, no delay. No delay typically means 5 to 10 minutes of holding. Or they may give you an estimated approach time. Yeah, it's fuel is important in the hold. Obviously, you may get an anticipated approach time from ATC. But we'll be looking at our fuel when we enter the hold. And what we need basically is enough fuel to fly the approach, enough fuel for a go around and diversion, and also have our minimum required fuel with our final reserve for landing. So all of that minus what we've got now gives us what we've got now minus those points. So what's in tanks minus the fuel for the approach, minus the diversion and go around fuel, and the minimum available fuel, which is at the moment 1 ton, 30 minutes of flying, will give us the fuel that we can currently hold up. So at the moment we've got a lot of extra time here. We're carrying a lot of extra fuel, but that's what we need to keep an eye on. How long can we stay in this hold? Now, when we're clear to exit the hold, we'll probably be a bit lower than 140 realistically, but the simple way of doing that is to come to your flight plan page and click exit. Let's see, resume hold comes up, re-enter it, and now because we've got no heading after Bovingdon, we'll direct Bovingdon, and then it will go into heading select, and we'll be radar vectors from Bovingdon down to the approach, runway 27 left at Heathrow today. That's how we exit the hold. You may of course be asked to fly a heading at any point by ATC, but generally they ask you to leave Bovingdon, for example, leave the VOR that you're holding over on a Pacific heading. That's how the exit's conducted. You can see here for all the Heathrow holds, as in the case of Bovingdon here, you cannot proceed beyond Bovingdon without ATC clearance. So it'd be fairly standard to actually set up the hold, enter it, and then once the clearance is received, click exit to leave the hold. So it's important to note some airfields that is the case. So that's holding. Just important to obviously interpret the chart information correctly. Make sure you're entering on the right course, whether it's a left-hand or right-hand turn, whether it's a time or distance-based hold, and ensuring that you're obviously entering, crossing the initial holding fix at the right altitude as provided by air traffic control. Getting your speed either green dot or you know, at the maximum speed, paying attention to the charts, and understanding the length of your delay and the fuel considerations. Any questions on that, please drop them in chat. Thanks for watching.